Hello, I'm Anand. I'm a member of the cybersecurity team in SandboxAQ, and I would like to talk to you about a recent paper of mine titled Trapdoor One-Way Function from Tensors. Despite there not being a cryptography in the title, it's very much a cryptography paper. Okay, so my intent is to give you, paint you a first impression of the paper. And the only thing I'll assume of the audience is that, you know, a little bit of linear algebra and a little bit of cryptography. It won't be too demanding. Before we dive into the details, perhaps we should pause and try to make sense of the words in the title. So the first expression in the title is, it's a trapdoor one-way function. So what are those? So these are a mainstay of cryptography. At a very high level, it's just a family of functions wherein each member, which is a function, has two descriptions, right? So a function is just a mapping from one set to another, and that could be very different ways of describing it. The first is sort of semantically a public description. The other is a secret or a trapdoor description, right? So under the public description, it's easy to compute the function one way, which is reflected in the title, one-way function, but hard to compute inverses or preimages. In contrast, this trapdoor description is more powerful. It has a little more information that enables one to also compute preimages. Trapdoor one-way functions are an important cryptographic primitive. Perhaps the most famous one is the one that underlies RSA signatures and the encryption schemes based on those. And there, in the public description, you have a bunch of numbers. And if you look at the trapdoor or secret description, like one of those numbers is written as a product of two primes. So it's that little subtlety, right? So they both describe the same function, but the description is different, and one allows you to compute preimages and the other doesn't. So these have been around since the dawn of cryptography, but there are still precious few of them. Like RSA is one of the most famous, and there are amazing trapdoor one-way functions from lattice-based cryptography, which is the foundation of post-quantum cryptography. But there's not much else. My intent was to try to find a little more diversity in the landscape of trapdoor one-way functions, and I looked to tensors. So what's a tensor? I mean, it depends on who you ask, as they say, and don't ask a physicist, I'm just kidding. So a tensor to us is just a cuboid of numbers. It's just a bunch of numbers where I is an index in the X direction, J is an index in the vertical Y direction, and K is an index in the Z direction. But for cryptography, these numbers have to come from a finite field. And this is required both for efficiency and for the security. For us, a tensor is just a cuboid of numbers from a finite field. You can just think of them as real numbers for now, right? And then, of course, like when you actually do cryptography, you have to go back to finite fields. So what do we do with tensors? And I must warn you that I'm going to ramble on about tensors for about 5 minutes. And for those who endure those 5 minutes, I promise a little bit of cryptography. So a tensor for us is always going to be three-dimensional. Everything I say works in higher dimensions, but I can't draw them. So everything today is going to be three-dimensional. We can multiply our tensor by vectors in three directions, right? So I've labeled them X, Y, and Z. Let's say we multiply by Y first. All you have to do is sort of slice the tensor into pancakes. You go to the jth slides and you multiply the jth slice by the jth coordinate of the Y vector. And then you all add them all up and you end up with a matrix. So now we are in a familiar position where we have a matrix and two vectors staring at it. And you can multiply by a vector as you please. Say we multiply by the Z vector and the result is a vector. And we have two vectors left now. One is X and the other one is the one we derived by multiplying the tensor by Y and Z. And then we multiply these two, we get a number. Okay, so essentially all there is to know about tensors until this point is that you can multiply a tensor by vectors in three directions and get a number. If you multiply them in one direction, you get a matrix. If you multiply them in two directions, you get a vector in the third direction. Okay, that's all you need to know. If none of that made sense to you and you're an algebraist, I've just written down the function that the tensor induces in an algebraic term. But the good news here is that when I write things down algebraically, you see that the order in which the vectors are multiplied to the tensor does not matter. I could have multiplied by Z first instead of Y, and it would have given me the same equation. Okay, so that's all there is about mumbling about tensors. We won't just use arbitrary tensors in our construction. We will use a very special one, and this was discovered by Weyman and Zelevinsky. But it's still very obscure, known only to a select few mathematicians. And the hope is that this work will bring it to light in the cryptographic circles. Okay. Some of you may know what a van der Moen matrix is. So a van der Moen matrix is constructed from a vector, right? And the vector is usually placed as a column or a row. And the other elements of the matrix are derived as powers of elements of the first row or the first column. So Weyman and Zelevinsky generalized this to tensors. And to construct a three-dimensional tensor, instead of starting with one vector, we need two vectors. Lambda is one of the vectors and zeta is the other vector. And from this, you can cook up a tensor. The ij kth element of the tensor is constructed as follows. You go to the ith coordinate of the lambda vector, lambda I, you write it down, and you raise it to the jth power, right? J is the index here. And likewise, you go to the ith coordinate of the zeta vector, you write it down, and you raise it to the kth power. And then you multiply the two, and this is going to be the ij kth tensor entry. And a priori, there is no reason why this is interesting, but trust me and trust Weyman and Zelevinsky that this is the right generalization of van der Moen matrices. And these tensors have a lot of magic to them. If the notation is a little confusing, I've just written out a very small example, right? So don't be scared. It's just another tensor with a lot of algebraic structure. So all the elements are derived from two vectors. And another thing to note here is that I've drawn my tensor wherein one of the dimension, the x dimension, is roughly equal to the length of the other two. And here I will always have x to be the larger dimension. Y and z are about the same length and x is twice the length. These van der Moen, Weyman, Zelevinsky tensors are critical ingredients in our construction. And in fact, we will construct random Weyman, Zelevinsky tensors. How do you do that? Well, you just construct two random vectors, and I'm going to demand that none of their entries are repeated, but don't worry about that. And once you choose two random vectors, you get a random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor. And this random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor is the most important ingredient of the secret private key that I promised. So the main secret is a random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor constructed by choosing two random vectors. But there is a little more to this trapdoor. And there are two more components, and these are two matrices, Y and Z. And these are both invertible matrices. Okay. And again, these two are chosen completely at random, with the only condition that they are invertible. Their role will be to multiply with vectors in the Y and Z dimensions respectively, and you'll see it later. Okay, so this is our secret. There's nothing more to it. One random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, two invertible matrices. That's it. And I haven't told you what the one-way function is. It's soon to come. But before that, what's the public description of the function? So the public description is going to be another tensor, which I'm going to call APUB, is going to be derived from the trapdoor. You take this random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, right? And you can construct a trilinear form out of it, which is just the function you get by multiplying on all three sides by vectors. Before I multiply in the y direction, the y vector, I'm going to multiply the y vector by this matrix first. And likewise, on the z direction, before I multiply the z vector, I'm going to run that vector through this matrix first, right? So all that is happening is that I'm twisting the original tensor, Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, by two basis changes in the y and z directions, right? And these two basis changes are also part of the secret. But once I twist that, I get another trilinear form, which I can write down as just a cuboid of numbers. And I'm going to call that as APUB. The crucial thing to note is that only the secret trapdoor knows this factorization in terms of a Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, which is highly structured and two basis changes. If I look at this public key tensor, which is derived as I just mentioned, this public key actually looks quite random. And this is a well-known cryptographic assumption. I did not introduce it. It's been studied before. And a lot of cryptographic systems have been built on it, right? So this is our trapdoor, and this is our public function. Okay, so what is the one-way function? The one-way function is very simple. It takes as argument two vectors, one in the y direction and one in the z direction, and it multiplies it with this public tensor. So when I multiply the public tensor with y and z, I'm going to get a result, which is a vector in the x direction. And the crucial property we want out of this one-way function is that if I'm just presented a public, then I can compute images, right? Because computing an image is just multiplying a tensor by two vectors. That's possible. But I should not be able to compute preimages. However, if I have the trapdoor, then I should be able to compute the preimages. And this is one of the technical parts of the paper. And I'll give you a hint as to how it is done. So the first thing to note is that if I can compute preimages with respect to the Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, that is, someone gives you a Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor and a desired sparse target and asks you for two vectors, y hat and z hat, such that if I multiply these two, I hit that target, right? Then I can convert that solution into one for our problem. So our problem is you're given a pub and you're given a sparse target x and you have to find y and z. And the reason is the trapdoor also consists of the two base change secret matrices, y capital and z capital. And I can just multiply the solution that I derive here with those matrices and I'll get the answer, right? So to transform a solution from Weyman-Zelevinsky to the public tensor, I need the secret basis. And to solve the problem when I'm posing it with respect to the Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor, you need a higher dimensional analog of Lagrange interpolation. And this is the technical part of the paper, which I'm afraid I won't have time to go into. But for those of you who are very familiar with van der Moen matrices, so you can use van der Moen matrices to argue about the correctness of Lagrange interpolation. And the analogy is very similar here, except it's a little more complicated and I only know how to do it for sparse targets. So that's why there is this constraint. So let's do some cryptography. So I'm going to do some digital signatures. So we have a signer, Alice, who has lots of messages to sign. And she wants to convince anyone who reads her message that it was indeed her who came up with the message, right? So let's say someone wants to verify it. Let's call him Bob. So we're going to give Alice the trapdoor, which consists of this random Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor and the two random base change matrices. And Bob is going to get only the public tensor, right, which was derived from this trapdoor. And so now Alice wants to sign her messages. And in deciding this protocol, we are going to exploit the property of this trapdoor one-way function. Namely, that we are going to make sure that anyone who is verifying only has to compute the function one way, which is taking two vectors, multiplying it with the tensor. And then Alice, who has the privileged knowledge of the trapdoor and who wants to convince everyone else that her messages are actually her own, she is going to be asked to do the pre-image computation, right? Okay, so here's the protocol. So first, Alice has a message M. She's going to append her message with a random salt. This is a cryptographic technique. It's important, but you can forget about the salt. So you can just think about Alice appending her message with some random bit strings to make sure everything works. Okay, so don't worry about it. She hashes this message and salt to get a sparse vector in the x direction. Okay, and this can be done using a cryptographic hash function whose image consists of sparse vectors. Then she uses her trapdoor. So she knows the Weyman-Zelevinsky tensor and she knows the two random base changes. And with this, she can compute a preimage which consists of a y vector and a z vector such that if you multiply it with the tensor, the public tensor, the result is going to be the hash of the message and salt. So this is the pre-image computation problem, which Alice can do since she has access to the trapdoor. And then she just transmits the message, the salt, and the signature, which consists of Y and Z. Okay, so that's it. And Bob or anyone else who desires to verify it will have access to this public key, which is just this public tensor. And their verification is very simple. They look at the signature, and from the signature, they know the message and the salt, and the hash function is public, so they can compute the hash of the message and salt and write down a sparse target vector. From the signature part, they know the vectors Y and Z, and the tensor A public is, of course, public by name. So Bob can multiply the tensor with these two vectors, and then he would get an X vector. And all he has to do is verify that the hash of the message and salt agrees with this X vector. So this is the protocol. And in fact, we can prove rigorously the only way anyone can pretend to be Alice and sign a message is by breaking one of the assumptions we had. If someone gives you a random tensor, then they can compute pre-images with respect to that tensor, or they can distinguish random tensors from the public tensors. This is sort of the bare bones skeleton of the scheme. Besides diversity of approaches, which is quite desirable in cryptography, I haven't really told you why this is interesting. Well, this is ongoing work, so the why part will become clear soon. But one very important takeaway is that this is the first time we have trapdoor one-way functions from tensors. So there were signature schemes from tensors before, but they were too long. And in all the NIST standardization competitions, they were thrown away in favor of other code-based or lattice-based systems primarily because the signatures were like way too long. But using this trapdoor approach, the signatures are actually fairly short. If you look at what Alice is sending beside the message and the salt, all she is sending is a couple of vectors. In all the previous schemes, like Alice would actually have to send a tensor, which is like a cube of numbers, which is cubic order of magnitude bigger than a tensor, right? So I'm hopeful that this is a first step in making tensor-based signature schemes a little more viable. It's still not as short as the best-known lattice-based cryptography systems, but I mean, those have been around for 30 years with a lot of advanced work. So I'm hoping that this is a start of some nice tensor-based cryptographic system. And I'll be happy to take questions. I'll try to hang around on the YouTube comments and answer anything I can see. But otherwise, you can write to me. Thank you.